Fall Fun Drive, October 16th to the 31st. If you own or manage a restaurant, catering company, or grocery, and would like to support KPFA's efforts, please contact Maria at 510-848-6767, extension 258, or email maria@kpfa.org.
And you are listening to KPFA in Berkeley, 94.1, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1:30. Stay tuned next for Making Contact. This week on Making Contact.
My mother would always say, I don't think it's Khrushchev's bombs that are going to kill us. I think it's the ones that are going off 145 miles from here. It's Eisenhower's bombs, actually, that are going to kill us. As it turns out, that was pretty much right.
There was risk associated with developing nuclear weapons. People were injured. People were exposed to radiation. Do I feel bad about that? Yes, I do. Do I think we did the right thing as a country? Absolutely. We had no choice.
The stories of the American nuclear experiment, in the words of the people who worked the Nevada test site and those who lived under the mushroom cloud. We'll hear the first of two parts of the documentary, Dirty Harry, When the American Dream Became a Nightmare. I'm Tina Rubio, and this is Making Contact, a program connecting people, vital ideas, and important information. In 1951, the first atom bomb was detonated over a section of desert called Frenchman Flat, 90 miles northwest of Las Vegas. For more than 40 years, this stretch of sagebrush and sand would become ground zero for U.S. nuclear testing. In fact, the last detonation happened just 15 years ago, in 1992. Since the early 1990s, independent producer Klaus Andreasen has interviewed test site workers, scientists, legal scholars, and test officials, as well as the people living downwind from the Nevada test site. Dirty Harry, When the American Dream Became a Nightmare, is a culmination of those interviews. This week and next, host John Brupe will be our guide as we hear the stories about the early years of testing and how it affected people working at and living nearby the test site.
Ladies and gentlemen, we interrupt this program to bring you important news. Word has just been received from the Atomic Energy Commission that due to a change in wind direction, the residue from this morning's atomic detonation is drifting in the direction of St. George. It is suggested that everyone remain indoors for 1 hour or until further notice. There is no danger.
On January 22, 1951, the first atomic weapon was detonated over a section of desert called Frenchman Flat, not far from where we're standing here in southern Nevada. It's a vast open space 90 miles northwest of Las Vegas, populated by coyotes, wild horses, and an occasional bighorn sheep. This expanse of sagebrush and sand would become ground zero for American nuclear weapons testing for more than 40 years. Over 100 atmospheric and more than 800 underground tests were conducted here. As the awesome blast ripped through the ground, a mushroom cloud with thousands of pounds of radioactive debris was sent into the air. It often drifted northeast into sparsely populated areas of Nevada and to small villages and towns in Utah. In 1953 alone, 11 atomic detonations were fired here at the Nevada Proving Grounds. It was the largest research program to date. One of the tests, Shot Harry, or Dirty Harry, as the locals would name it later, was a 32-kiloton blast that detonated in the early morning of May 19, 1953. Harry blew up at 5 minutes past 5 in the morning. Sheep farmer Kern Bullock had spent the last couple of months at a winter camp in Nevada unaware of what had just happened 100 miles southwest.
And this one morning, we just pulled from Sand Spring Valley over Coyote Pass and going into Tickaboo Valley. And I was sitting there on the horse and just had my legs cocked up out of the stirrups over the saddle horn because it was easy to ride that way. And I had them just sitting on and watching the sheep. They were all spread out. And all at once, that bomb went off. So I told Jay, I says, well, Jay, I'll get down and go around the leaders and turn them back, and you cook breakfast. Have breakfast, and then we come up and eat, and we'll go on. So I rode my horse down around the lead and turned the lead back, and the doggone cloud come up like, just like a mushroom, and spread out. The way I remember it was kind of a blue-gray cloud. I didn't know what was in it or anything like that, but it had sucked dirt in that up. And it come up, and it just mushroomed out. And it was just like, well, looking that way, and it come right square over the top of us, where we were.
It didn't take very long until two military vehicles showed up on a little dirt road leading to Kern and Jay's winter campsite.
They had protective coverings on their shoes and on their head, kind of a plastic stuff. Mm-hmm. And this guy got out, and I said, my God, man, what are you doing out here? Where did this herd of sheep come from? He says, you're in a hell of a hot spot. He says, where'd they come from? And I said, we've been here all winter.
A vast network of communications is mobilized while the press swings feverishly into action in the pre-dawn darkness overhanging Yucca Flats. And cameramen adjust their telephoto lenses on the tower 7 miles away. Motion picture men are tense awaiting the big moment.
Newsman's Knob was the spot where the media went in the 1950s to witness an atomic blast. The early morning commotion also attracted a couple of the many employees at the test site. Hal Curtis of Las Vegas was an iron worker there.
There was a whole bunch of people in a little place called Newsmen's Knob, they called it then. It was just an outcropping of a lot of rocks over there and sagebrush with a 4x4 post with a loudspeaker on it stuck up in the air. So we wandered over there. That was the only people around. And some of them had them great big radiation glasses so they didn't have to cover their heads up. And we didn't have one of them. Our buddy had a welding hood, and he was going to look at that thing through that welding hood, and I kept telling him I didn't think it was strong enough, but he was hard-headed. But anyhow, none of us knew each other, you know, and we're standing there listening to this loudspeaker going, and gets down there to about 15 seconds to detonation while this guy over the loudspeaker tells us to turn around and face away from Francis Flats. So at the count of about three, we all wrapped our arms around our heads. The ones didn't have radiation glasses, except my buddy. He had his welding hood on. God, I could see the bones in my arms with my eyelids shut. That's the brightest light I'd ever seen in my life. And all of a sudden, we're all on our butts. That blast came along, hit you in the back of the knees, and you're not expecting it. Down you go. You know? My buddy, he's in bad shape because he can't see. It wasn't dark enough. The guy tells us we can turn around and look towards that patient. Well, there's that mushroom cloud going up, and here's fire coming across that desert. You know, at a pretty good pace. Sagebrush is burning. Telephone poles are on fire, and it's just creeping along there, you know. Well, about that time, we're all on our butt again, because that wind that had went out caused a vacuum. It came back in and knocked us on our butts, and when the wind came whipping down across there again, it put the fire out. So I tell my blind friend there, I said, watch any more of these, I'm going to sit down. Well, he says, get knocked down twice, because some of the people had hurt, because they lit on them rocks, you know. But that was the first one. It terrorized me, and the last one terrorized me. There's something awesome about them detonations.
It is indeed awesome. In fact, it's difficult to find words to describe it.
The immense power of a nuclear blast even surprised and astonished the officials at the test site. Troy Wade, who later became Assistant Secretary of Energy for the entire U.S. nuclear complex, was test manager at the Nevada test site starting in late 1950s.
When I first arrived at the test site in 58, I got to see the last few atmospheric tests that were done in 58, and then a couple of more in 61, the actual last ones before the limited test ban treaty. But the light and the heat and shock wave from a nuclear weapon exploding are terrifying. I mean, you feel the heat, you feel the shock wave, you are blinded if you don't have your eyes closed or have on goggles, and it's an awful thing. Every leader of the world should have to look at one of those at some time, and I think it would make them understand a little more.
This is basic civil defense information from the Department of Defense, Office of Civil Defense, Washington. When a nuclear bomb or missile explodes near the ground, great quantities of earth and debris are sucked up into the fireball and carried by the prevailing winds before falling back to earth. This material is radioactive fallout. The particles look like grains of salt or sand. Fallout gives off invisible gamma rays like X-rays, and heavy exposure to it can cause serious radiation sickness, even death.
...140 miles east of the test site, just across the state line to Utah, is St. George. In the early 1950s, this was a small, quaint Mormon town surrounded by oxidized red mountain ridges, with the Linen White Temple in the center of the town of 16,000. Elmer Pickett had just left his former career as a mortician and opened a hardware store. In the early years, the town folk had little idea what was going on there on the other side of the mountains. These spectacular early morning events drew people into the streets to watch.
You'd see the whole western sky light up, just almost you could read a newspaper. And then shortly thereafter, you'd feel the ground kind of like a light, slight earthquake, tremble a little. And then right after daylight, short time after, these huge rolling red clouds would come over. God, we'd stand out, boy, that really looked like something. These huge rolling red clouds, a little different. And some people got out in it, and actually their hair would fall out. It grew back later, but they'd like to get a terrific sunburn. And that's when we started to wonder about, is this safe? And we started having, particularly by 1955, by then we'd had people start to die.
Elmer Pickett, St. George, Utah. Helped the crew from Little Babe to their great grandpa. My, how things have changed since 1951. When the word came round that the A-bomb testing had begun. And the dust that fell into their lives took away nine of Mr. Pickett's family ties. And as he mourned the death, five-year-old, the government washed their hands and his blood ran cold. Oh, he was a downwinder, but he didn't know hurt her. Downwinder, please, the no justice, downwind, downwinder. The downwinders now.
When the invisible cloud had passed, the total amount of radiation deposited on St. George was far from hazardous. The Atomic Energy Commission doesn't take chances on safety.
This is part one of Dirty Harry, when the American dream became a nightmare. Coming up next.
I was truly living the American dream. We were. We had three wonderful children. My husband had a good job. I had a job. We lived in the most beautiful place on earth, you know. Was living what we thought was the American dream. And it did. It actually turned into a nightmare.
You're listening to Making Contact, a production of the National Radio Project. If you'd like more information or for CD copies of this program, please call 800-529-5736. You can also download programs or get our podcast at radioproject.org. We now return to Dirty Harry, when the American dream became a nightmare. a documentary about atomic testing in southern Nevada and its effects on people working at the test site or living nearby.
The residue from this morning's atomic detonation is drifting in the direction of St. George. It is suggested that everyone remain indoors for 1 hour or until further notice. There is no danger.
Surrounded by Red Rock Mountains in the southwestern corner of Utah is St. George. In the early 1950s, it was home to 16,000 people, predominantly Mormons. They were patriotic and supported our nation's leaders. When the pink mushroom cloud slowly drifted across the mountain ridges, many of the town folks went outside to watch the early morning spectacle. Some went up to the ridges to get a better view. Something that almost looked like snow fell from the passing clouds. They rarely had snow in St. George, and as children, they would walk through it, write their names on cars, and get under the trees and shake it down, pretending that it was snow. Many people in St. George trusted the reassuring words from the Atomic Energy Commission, the AEC, proclaiming,
There is no danger.
But eventually people started to wonder. Longtime resident Michelle Thomas recalls,
"We, as school children, were filed into the auditorium, single file. I remember walking behind Mrs. Lim, you know, just marching into the one classroom after another, and they'd have these tables lined with white butcher paper and certain implements and little cups, little Dixie cups of water and these little pellets. And then you would go through the line, and a doctor would stand behind you and put his hands around your throat and feel for something. You know, you didn't know what they were doing, but you'd take a sip of water and they'd say, sip, hold, swallow. Sip, hold, swallow. You know, and then they'd squeeze your throat till you thought, easy for you to say, I can't swallow. And so what they were doing was checking to see if we had enlarged thyroid. And then they started taking children's thyroids out.
There was a turtle by the name of Bert. And Bert the turtle was very alert. When danger threatened him, he never got hurt. He knew just what to do. He ducked and cover. Ducked and cover. Ducked and cover.
The man would come to school with Geiger counters, and the man told me mine went off because I'd had dental x-rays, and I hadn't. My mother was a nurse. I knew I hadn't. And I remember my sister got big brown pills when they left class every day, which was potassium iodine. We didn't know, but we thought, God, why does their class get pills, you know, get to take this, and we don't.
Claudia Peterson grew up in St. George. As a child, she remembers seeing piles of dead sheep, little lambs with only two legs, or no legs at all. But at the time, she thought this was just the way things were, that it was normal. It wasn't until her youngest daughter, Bethany, got sick that she started to become concerned.
When Bethany was three, she was sick and complained of a lot of different things. I took her to five doctors here, and they kept telling me nothing was wrong with her. She was just constipated, and we'd go through the whole rounds of all this, and finally ended up taking her in the middle of the night to Salt Lake. And at that time, she was diagnosed with stage 4 neuroblastoma, which is a cancer that's in embryo and for some reason just goes crazy. And was in her bones, in her bone marrow, and they gave us a 5% chance she'd live 2 years.
Remarkably, Bethany beat the blastoma, but it wouldn't be long before she fell sick again.
I took her back to Salt Lake, and she was diagnosed with a totally different cancer, acute monoblastic leukemia. Drove home on Valium, just crazy, crying all the way with her and the car, and I got home and my sister died that day. So we were totally devastated, and Bethany died a month later.
Ladies and gentlemen, we interrupt this program to bring you important news. There is no danger.
I fight really hard. Every time I do it, I think, I'm going to do it this time without crying. And I can't. there's so much heartache there. I miss them so much. So it never goes away. I lost my father, my sister, my daughter. If I just walked away from this, I wouldn't... I don't know if I could ever make peace with it. This is my way of dealing with it. I always am the one that benefits. After I do something or something, I really feel closer to Bethany and Kathy when I'm doing something in their honor. Because I don't want their deaths to be forgotten, and I don't want the legacy of their lives to have meant nothing.
Hey, man.
How you doing?
Okay.
Here, put this on the bill, will you?
Oh, okay.
Elmer Pickett, the owner of the hardware store in St. George, started to wonder if something was not right and began making a list of the family members that he had lost to cancer.
As far back as we can check on all of our records, we have never had one single case of cancer anywhere in our family prior to this fallout. And the only ones in our family who had this happen to them are those who lived here. None of the other family members anywhere else around who had moved away, who had not been living here, have any cancer even to this day. I kept this little record that I made of the family members who I have lost from the fallout that's lost to cancer. Starts out with my wife, Viola, and my sister, and my niece, and my grandmother, and my mother-in-law, sister-in-law, three great-uncles, four great-uncles, and an aunt, and a brother-in-law, and then I also just lost a first cousin just very recently who died from liver and stomach cancer that I'm sure, and we feel certain, was caused from that. I have still living a cousin that lives just a block from my home, mm-hmm. who has larynx cancer, had to have her whole voice box removed, and she's still fighting it. And then I have a daughter who is suffering from thyroid problems, not cancer yet. Hope it never is.
When this interview was recorded in 1992, there were 13 family members on Elmer Pickett's list. In 1998, Elmer himself would be added to this list as well.
Hiroshima, Nagasaki, Alamogordo, Bikini.
I'm going to preach y'all a sermon about old man Adam, that's me. I don't mean the Adam in the Bible, Adam. I don't mean the Adam that Mother Eve elated. I mean the thing that science liberated. The thing that Einstein says he's scared of. And when Einstein's scared, brother, you'd better be scared. If you're scared of the atom, here's what you gotta do. You gotta gather all the people in the world with you, cause if you don't get together and do it, well, first thing you know, I'm gonna blow this world plumb too.
Hiroshima, Nagasaki, Alamogordo, Bikini.
But the atom's here in spite of hysteria. It flourishes in Utah as well as Siberia. And whether you're a black, white, red, or brown, the question is this when you boil it down. To be or not to be, that's the question. The answer to it all ain't military atom, like who gets there first is with the mostest atoms. No, the people of the world must decide their fate. They gotta get together or disintegrate. So listen, folks, here is my thesis. Peace in the world or the world in pieces.
Hiroshima, Nagasaki, Alamogordo, Bikini.
Elmer Pickett wasn't the only one trying to keep track of what was going on in town. Michelle Thomas.
My mother would always say, I don't think it's Khrushchev's bombs that are going to kill us. I think it's the ones that are going off 145 miles from here. It's Eisenhower's bombs, actually, that are going to kill us. As it turns out, that was pretty much right. she was just a forecaster of doom as far as I'm concerned. It was like, okay, you know, let's all gather around the dinner table and discuss that we're all going to die of cancer. I mean, it wasn't your most cheery conversation. And then she started making this chart with the homes of every house in the neighborhood within a one-block radius. And then if someone developed cancer or leukemia or Hodgkin's disease or any of the other inexplicable maladies, she'd put an X on their home. And it wasn't very long before maybe only two houses on her chart didn't have an X. And then she extended it to a three-block radius of our home.
The residue from this morning's atomic detonation is drifting in the direction of St. George. There is no danger.
A little further north of St. George, in Cedar City, sheep farmer Kern Bullock had returned from winter camp, where he experienced the Dirty Harry explosion. And Kern could tell that something was the matter with the sheep.
God, they just started dying like flies, you know. There'd be 100 head of sheep dead, and we'd throw them on a truck and haul them off, and put them in a pile out here, what they call 8 mile. We'd haul them off and figure we had all that was going to die. We'd come back in to feed them the next morning, and there'd be another 100 head laying there dead around those mangers. We couldn't figure what was happening. And it wasn't just our herd that was doing it. It was all of them, all the sheep that had been out there in Nevada. The atomic energy vets came into our yards like this. They autopsied them. They'd say, oh, this is a hot one. Geez, this is a hot one. These are all hot, you know. And we'd take them out to piles of dead ones that we had hauled out. They'd put those Geiger counters wide. The needle's going clear off the poles. These are really hot.
Kern Bullock wasn't the only sheep farmer who noticed that there was something unusual going on. A little further east, Kent Carroll also started finding sick sheep. The wool came out in big patches, and they had sores around their mouths. But the sheep were not the only ones showing signs of radiation sickness. Here's Kent's sister, Janet Gordon.
He said that his horse had been sick. He said when he would ride down in the low washes and brushy areas where there was scrub oak, that there was like a ground fog. But he could taste it. It had a metallic taste. And he could feel it on his skin. Well, within a matter of a few weeks, the horse got down. It was a young horse, good healthy horse, a nice horse. Got down, couldn't get up. The vet couldn't figure out anything wrong with him. He never did. Within a few days, he died.
It wasn't very long before Kent himself started feeling sick. He complained about headache, feeling nauseous, and he had what looked like burn marks on his arms and on his face. At first, the doctors didn't know what it was. But later, Kent was diagnosed with a tumor in his pancreas that grew quickly.
It got bigger and bigger, and he was so young and healthy, except for that cancer that was eating him up, that he finally starved to death, died from malnutrition, because his food couldn't digest anymore, and painful. It was as big as a basketball, and the skin was stretched so tightly over his bones, his eyes couldn't close, and his mouth couldn't close. And he couldn't lay his legs out straight. And I remember lying beside him just before he died, the night before he died, propping his legs up because he was a little more comfortable than if we propped him with a pillow, praying that he could die.
That's it for this edition of Making Contact. You are listening to the first part of Dirty Harry, When the American Dream Became a Nightmare, written and produced by Klaus Andreasen and hosted by John Bupre. Special thanks to KNPR for production assistance. Support for this documentary came in part from the PRX Reversioning Project. Next week on Making Contact, we'll hear the second part of this documentary. Special thanks to Dan Turner and the Monday Morning Breakfast crew. Our theme music is by the Charlie Hunter Trio. For a CD copy of program number 4107, call the National Radio Project at 800-529-5736, or you can get our podcast at radioproject.org. Lisa Rudman is our executive director, Puck Lowe associate producer, Samson Rainey and Joaquin Palomino interns, and I'm Tina Rubio. Thanks for listening to Making Contact.
KPFA accepts no underwriting or sponsorship from corporations. You, our beloved community of listeners, are our lifeblood. I'm Lim Lim Rijo, KPFA Interim General Manager, here to thank you for your continued financial contributions that keep us thriving as a beacon of independent media. As the independent voices in media become fewer and fewer, it's become extremely crucial for the voices of KPFA.